Without further ado, I would like to introduce our keynote for today. Taking to the stage to facilitate the discussion will be the fabulous Phoebe Pinnock. Phoebe is a multi-talented and hardworking lady. She's a hard rock and metal singer and songwriter who fronts the band Heaven the Axe. Not only that, she also does a Dolly Parton tribute show called Everyone Loves Dolly. Yes, they do. And I think anyone who can be in a metal band and do Dolly Parton is a bit of a legend. She works tirelessly as the Regional Officer for Music New South Wales for the Wagga region. She puts on some incredible programs, events, festivals, and is just helping to create a really thriving music community here. Phoebe is speaking with one of the amazing workshop mentors for today, who is Wayne Connolly. I could be here all day reading out a bio for Wayne. I'll try not to do that, so I wanted to just pull out a few highlights to explain how very, very fortunate we are to have him here with us. Wayne Connolly is an ARIA award-winning producer, engineer, musician and composer with over 2 decades experience in the music industry. Over his career, he's worked with over 200 bands and artists, engineering and producing. Bands such as Underground Lovers, Died Pretty, The Foves, Grant McLennan, Custard, UMI, Hungry Kids of Hungary, The Paper Kites, All Our Exes Live in Texas, Boy and Bear, Dallas Crane, Youth Group, Josh Pike, The Living End, Jimmy Barnes, and some guy named Neil Finn. Wayne writes for film and TV. Some of his credits include Friday on My Mind, The Kettering Incident, Black Balloon, and Little Fish. Things like in 92, he produced the Underground Lovers album Leaves Me Blind, which received Rolling Stone magazine's Best Australian Record. 96, he won his first ARIA for the engineer on UMI's Hourly Daily. 2007, couple more ARIAs as engineer and producer of the year for Josh Pike's album Memories and Dust. 2010, engineer of the year for Paul Dempsey, Fast Friends. He's also a musician and a songwriter. He started the band The Welcome Mat, who were the first band ever to play Australia's Big Day Out. That's pretty amazing. He's toured extensively around Australia with the likes of the Hoodoo Gurus, Died Pretty, Buffalo Tom, The Lemonheads, The Wonder Stuff, UMI, Smudge, and Bob Dylan. Need I say any more? Please welcome Phoebe and Wayne to the stage with a very warm welcome of applause.
Thanks, Caroline. Hello, everyone. How are you going? So nice to see you all here. Thanks for coming along for this wonderful day. We're really lucky to have the wonderful people from APRA put this event on and choose Wagga as one of the locations to bring the day's workshop to. I'm really honoured to be here. I work for Music New South Wales. I'm part-time regional music officer. So what that means basically is that if I don't know you, please come and say hello. I'd love to hear about you and your music and what you're doing. And I can give you my card and I'd love to hear more about what you're doing and give you some help if you need any help in particular. But for now, I'd love to have a wonderful chat with this curious gentleman who happens to come from Wagga Wagga. Welcome, Wayne.
Indeed. Thanks for having me.
It's so nice to have you here in this wonderful, thriving metropolis of the Cuba here, which is decked out so nicely, I must say, by the team at APRA.
Yeah.
But thanks for coming along to have a chat with everyone here today. I see some very familiar faces and am aware about the songwriting talent that is in this town, and it's so exciting to know the burgeoning level of where things are at, being that there's a new scene really developing at the moment. So no doubt this conversation will be of great value to a lot of the people in the room today.
Yeah.
So.
Yes, well, it's great to be back because I spent my childhood here living in the tiny hamlet of Gumley on the outskirts of town.
Yeah, exactly. Tell us about what it was like growing up in Wagga and how your love of music developed.
I was sort of growing up in the punk new wave era, and we lived at Gumley. My older brother had played in bands before. I came from a very big family, 9 kids. And naturally, you know, there was a lot of, in that era, my parents would be like, okay, you've got to get a proper job. You're not going to be playing music. And so there was no real encouragement or anything, and my brother was seen as a tearaway for playing in a band. And in that era, there was no real precedent for people that came from Wagga and made it in the music scene, really. I think the only person I could think of at that time was a guy, Richard Bergman. And I don't know if you know, Richard was in a band called the Sunny Boys, who were a great new wave band in the early 80s. As far as I knew, that was the only precedent, really. Years later, only recently, I found out, which I didn't know. I met a great Wagga band called the Ocean Party. Has anyone heard of them? They were on Spunk Records more recently in the last 10 years. And I said to them, you must be one of the best bands to come from Wagga. And they said, well, Ivor Davies might have something to say about that. And I was like, Ivor Davies? And they told me that he'd grown up in Wagga. And I didn't realise that, but I met him subsequently about a year ago. And I said, did you grow up in Wagga? And he said, yeah, I was there till I was 9 or 10. And he said, I lived, Lake Albert Road. He said, the bit where the houses run out and it just turns into farmland. I lived in the last house there. So, that's an image for you, a mental image that the man of colours lived in that last house on Lake Albert Road going out into the country, yeah.
How interesting. It's fascinating. Growing up, I knew of Ivor Davies coming from Wagga. So that
he certainly kept it quiet that he was from Wagga, though.
Yeah.
Maybe that's where his love of windsurfing came from, though, I reckon. Lake Albert windsurfing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be, I reckon.
You would get an ear infection if you did that at this point, or worse. But
they always say they've cleaned up the lake. It's always like, it's fine.
They've got a nice walking track.
Okay,
that's recommended, but probably not swimming at this point.
Yeah.
But it's always exciting to know of those that have come before you, especially being in a regional town. I know when I was growing up here, and I don't know what it was like for you, I'm guessing it was probably the same, but I just couldn't wait to get out of this town and begin my life in music somewhere else.
Yeah.
Whereas these days things are really opening up to a different realm of being able to work with people because we have the internet, being able to promote yourself, being able to connect with people. But tell us about, I know you said that you went to Kringle High and St Mick's.
Oh, yeah. No, we're talking the ancient times here.
Did you play music at school?
And I was going to say, that's exactly. People had to leave for sure to achieve anything. In Wagga then, if you wanted to find out about music, you'd have to go down to Abraxas Music on Baylor Street and hang out and talk to the guys behind the counter.
Yeah.
And they knew how to hire a PA and do all that stuff. In those days, we used to rehearse. Our drummer had, his father was John Rosengreen, the music teacher at Kringle High. So we would rehearse in the drama theatre at Kringle High. But we went to the Catholic school and... one of our first bands I was an eclectic sort of writer. One of our first bands was called The Eye Appealing End Result, and we used to play. Someone remembers. and we used to play the Johnny Mac and Romanos. We're all underage, of course. It was terrifying, the whole thing. We'd play the occasional rock mass down in the grotto at Mount Aaron. To this day, I'm pretty convinced that we did a version of Jesus Is Just All Right by the Doobie Brothers down in the grotto, Mount Aaron. And a side note, so our drummer in that era was a guy called Scott Casley, and I'm diverging very quickly here, but he went on to form a great comedy group called the Found Objects, and they became Leno and Woodley, so you often see Leno and Woodley on the TV. And there's one great Leno and Woodley episode where the whole episode is based around a rock mass, and I always think of that era and the inspiration that came from Scott and me playing a rock mass.
That is very cool.
They were groovy back then, let me tell you.
Well, it's always good to know about the history and what came before you, because I know as you get a bit older I move back to Wagga and I have an understanding of what things were like 20 years ago, which is now getting on, but having an understanding of
how good it was. Ancient time.
Yeah.
I think because there were great venues and the Johnny Mac was a great venue. It was like an old 60s nightclub or something in LA. It was all like, I think it was booths and maybe, planter boxes and things. And it was a scuzzy sort of punk venue. And we'd often go and see a band called The Lungs there, and The Lungs were... the preeminent Wagga band. They were fantastic. They play a lot of punk stuff and Iggy Pop and Lou Reed and stuff. And then they play all these songs that they pretended were theirs, but I found out years later they were all by bands like the Dead Boys and all these American punk bands. Our band, just very quickly, I'll try and make this point. Our band was very much third or fourth tier. We weren't anywhere near that level. we'd play some punk songs and our own songs. We had a classic called Mafia in the MIA, which was very hard-hitting. But we also, I think, I was very eclectic, and I think that's maybe helped me in my career, but at the time it was like, you know, I was such a fake punk. But we used to play all these punk songs. Then we'd play The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down by the band. And I remember playing the Wagga at Teachers College, and all the lungs came to see us for the first time. We played Lou Reed, White Light, White Heat, and a few other groovy songs. And then we played The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down. And they all this whole entourage just stormed out going, "You fakes, you fucking fakes." Oh, wow. Scarred me for life. But I took away, I had a takeaway. We didn't call them takeaways then, but my lesson there was that you do have to try and carve out a unique and original niche for yourself, and not sort of follow things too much. And I think when you were talking about doing metal and Dolly Parton, I think that's sort of, maybe that's particular to regional things, where you just got to do everything you can and try and please everyone. And someone's brother is going to, you know, say you're an idiot because you play this stupid music and stupid punk music. Yeah. Anyway.
Well, that's right. When you're building a career in music and you have one thing in mind and you like one thing, or maybe you like more than one thing. Like, I know with my music, for example, I write a nice song and my husband destroys it because he likes two sorts of music, heavy and metal. So,
right.
And I write nice songs, like to think they are, and I just kind of, you know, I love him. He's a great guitarist, so I go along with it and we have a great time.
Yeah.
But, you know, sometimes you have to make choices, and things, opportunities present themselves. So you end up, you do things and you work into a direction that you probably never would have seen coming.
Yeah.
And I'm sure in your lengthy career that you've had different twists and turns, and you've gone from being a punk wild youth here in Wagga into being an excessively successful Australian producer.
Mm.
But once you left Wagga and went to Sydney, I know that you've mentioned that you had quite an extensive career with Alberts.
Mm.
And can you tell us a bit about the time of your life when you left Wagga, went to Sydney, and then a bit about what Alberts was for you?
Yes, a pretty long, circuitous path. But I was maybe going to make the point that just making connections and stuff in the music industry is really valuable, and just, you know, making a start, going out there and just doing something, taking a first step is so important. So I'd been doing it a long time, and I'd already, won ARIAs or whatever, but it was a really valuable time in my life when I came to work at Alberts. And Alberts, if you don't know, are the label that had AC/DC, and they'd actually been going for 140 years as a publisher. They were really old school. They started out selling pianola rolls and violin strings. So yeah, I got to work with them in their studio for about 10 years probably, and it was just a great experience for me to work with, or just meet people like Vander and Young and all the people that were around the studio at that time. And that, in that period, met work with Barnsey and Neil Finn and everyone through that, I guess, the connections that they had, the Alberts people had. I think years later, yeah, I worked with a band called Dallas Crane. And that's how I came to be involved with Alberts. I was doing their album. They signed to Alberts when we were doing their album. And years later, I sort of said to them, "How did that come about? How did you get me?" Which changed my life when I did them and made this connection. "How did you come to get me to produce your album?" And they were like, "Oh yeah, a flatmate sort of liked your band and said we should get you." It was like, "Who was your flatmate?" And it was like, "Oh, Craig from a band called Jersey." And Jersey had supported my band 3 years before in Melbourne, and I'd liked his band. And just that, yeah, these random connections from us going and playing a terrible show at, I forget the venue near Victoria Markets in Melbourne, to 10 people. But somehow that came through in years later and became an opportunity that was very valuable to me. Yeah.
Crazy how life can have twists and turns like that. I remember one of the best pieces of advice I was given when I first moved to Melbourne by an incredible guitarist, Finbar O'Hanlon. He's an extraordinarily incredible, intelligent man. He does TED Talks and all sorts of things. And he said to me, people might just help you just because they like you. that, you know, it can just come down to a personal relationship, and that was one of the first things I learned into my Melbourne music industry experience, which was incredibly valuable, because that certainly proves true. Being a nice person, or, you know, somebody likes you, is going to form a great connection. But apart from that, you've got to have the talent to back it up underneath everything. So going from being a musician in a punk band to a producer, how did that kind of come about for you?
Well, I think it relates to something else maybe I was going to talk about, but I think in that era you couldn't really get in a studio unless you were signed to a record label. Through the 80s and even into the 90s, there was no way to make a record that we knew of, that unless you signed to Warner's or something and got a huge budget and went into a studio. And studios were worth, you know, up to $2,000 a day back in the 80s, which is when terrace houses were, you know, 40,000 in Sydney. So it was like you could buy a terrace with an album budget very, very easily. Yeah, and so I always really wanted to learn to record. I had some friends in a band called the Hummingbirds, and they were like an indie band, and they made it to the top 40, and they worked in a big studio, and that was highly unprecedented in that era. I came to it completely randomly again. It was like I was sitting at home. I used to work in software, actually, and I was working for a company, Fairlight, that made the music samplers. And I was on the dole after leaving there.
Hello?
Yeah, I've got to finish this. Bear with me, it's an incredible story. No, not really. I was on the dole, yeah. And I had no aspirations to do anything. I just didn't know what to do. And my family wanted me to go and visit my uncle and get a job at CSIRO. And I was like, oh my God, I don't want to do that. Hopefully they're not filming this now. Okay. Someone came and knocked on my door and said, oh, there's an ad for a studio manager. And it was Paradise Studios that belonged to Billy Field. And it was run by INXS's management, Chris Murphy. And I kind of got the job through that connection and just became a producer-engineer out of that, really. I met UMI and all those people in that era from working at Paradise.
Yeah. Did you have any knowledge when you went in to do that job? Or?
No, I bluffed my way into the job. Yeah, I had an interview with I think he was INXS's road manager, Mike Fronzek. And he asked me all these tricky questions and I just was absolutely stunned. I didn't know what to say, but I guessed the answer to two questions. Well, and he was like, yeah, all right.
Phone a friend. That is amazing.
Yeah.
What an amazing fork in the road for you in your journey.
That was a
where you were going
thing.
From being on the dole to being in this incredible space.
Yeah, it was a great world. And then, you know, my first day on the job was Andrew Farris from INXS came in to produce Jenny Morris. And
wow.
It was terrifying.
Yeah.
Andrew Farris yelling at me on the first day, my first day of work, going, I don't care if it's your first day. Just get this speaker working, all right? It was like everything was broken and the whole studio was kind of, you know, faltering and failing.
Oh, no. Yeah. And he's paying big bucks.
He was paying probably $2,000 a day, yeah.
Oh, my goodness. That sounds like a really stressful situation. But obviously you excelled in it because you forged a career through that path. And that, I know we've had a chat about whether or not, you know, back in those era was very much about analog recording, but these days we're going into a digital realm.
Yeah.
What are some of the differences that you might see between what you were dealing with then as opposed to now? What producers are dealing with, or what you
The transition's pretty much fully complete now, isn't it? I mean, I work in digital all the time now. I don't very occasionally like to go back and use analog, but it's like a rarity, really. You'd have to have a good budget to do it, and not many studios have tape machines anymore. But yeah, all through that era it was really nice to work with tape. Tape's something that is a natural compressor of music, so it naturally limits everything, and you don't actually have to get things to sound as good. Like if a drummer can't play as well, you sort of don't notice, because it's like it's compressed and it's And whereas in digital, it's got massive head range. And for drummers, uneven in their playing or whatever, you can hear every bit of unevenness sort of thing. obviously you can compress everything and do everything in Pro Tools now, but tape did it very naturally and very quickly and easily because it's like a very fast limiter. But yeah, that's a thing in those days with tape machines. Nobody could really afford to record. It was like you got to, like I was saying, have a huge budget to do it. And now everyone can record, and a lot of records I do are people sending me their home recordings. I just did a new one with Josh Pike, and he did it all in his, you know, shed. And I sort of added things and mixed it. And, he's just focused on making records as quickly and cheaply as possible. So,
right.
And, yeah, there's a lot of that going on where it's all just passing around digital files. And yeah.
Wow. So Josh Pike being somebody that you're working with now, and the fact that he is doing things quickly and cheaply, is that something that you've developed a great relationship with him over a number of years to be able to get to the point where he can just ring you up and say, hey, can you just fix this up?
Yeah, for sure. He went out and bought the stuff that I had when we worked together years ago.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you using? And write it all down. Okay. And then so he bought, you know, some vintage mics and good equipment. And
tell us a bit about that. That's something I know that there's people in the room that will be really keen to hear is what are some of the, you know, the must-have items that Wayne Connolly likes to use.
Right. Well, unfortunately, I've been in studios a long time, so I have had access to very expensive, high-end sort of stuff. So I'm kind of used to that. And it's
people sort of ask borrowed.
Me, every week someone asks me, what cheap valve mic sounds just like a U47? I'm like, I don't know, none of them. But they kind of are getting better and better, all these sort of boutique mics. But I'm sort of used to using esoteric vintage, like Neumann U67 is my favourite, and I've got one of those. And it's just a marvellous, you know, all-round mic that you can use on anything, drums. But they're not cheap. They're very expensive these days.
How much is something like that worth?
I think they're about $15,000 each, so, yeah. And they've actually just reissued it, and it's just for anyone who has technical interest. They've made an exact reissue, and it doesn't sound good at all. And it's $9,000. And there's a guy on the internet who's written a huge account of why it doesn't sound the same, and all the parts you have to change to make it sound like an old one. And you can eventually, if you change, you know, half the parts in it, yeah. Oh,
wow, so you actually have to pull out half the parts to make it sound like...
Yeah, but not so bad. Like, you know, the valve, get a new old stock valve, all these kind of... Sorry to go into a technical detour here.
No, it's good to know. And you use Pro Tools? Is that your main...
I do, yeah, and Logic as well. So, yeah, you guys probably... have some sort of recording platform, do you, or digital?
How many people here have a recording platform at home that they're using?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. It's an expensive medium now. They try to trap you into the subscription thing, and that's really hard, whereas Logic, you can just buy it $400, whatever, and you've got it forevermore. So Logic's probably the best option, really, because it's got all the instruments built in as well, and they all sound good, and it's an easy medium where you can get drum loops and drag them in, and you probably already know all this, but they have an intelligent drummer where you can just get a square pad and move the cursor around and get different drum beats as you move the cursor. It's pretty advanced in that way.
And you can do many takes, like obviously with the tape, and back in the old days when you're recording analog, you had to nail it on the one go, so you'd have to be a wonderful performer at the same time. But did they actually cut the tape and stick it together?
I did a lot of editing, but only in the very last phases of tape. I got really good at it. It was very hard and very stressful. Nick Launay is a great producer who lived in Australia for a long time and did In Excess and The Birthday Party, and now he's done some big records. I think he's got a number one in England, Idols or something at the moment. But he was a mad tape cutter, and he did Midnight Oil, 10, 9, 8, 7, and he was someone who gave me a little bit of instruction about it, how to cut tape. And you cut the 2-inch tape, and you'd always have to do it on an angle, and you have to wobble it back and forth. It's a very difficult process.
You're shaky. Like, am I getting this right?
Or you'd make the mark on the tape and then chop bits out. But I did ask him once, so, you know, what happens if something goes wrong? Well, I'd always do it after the band had gone home. And he was like, well, you just get them to record it again. And I'd be like, oh, right. That was that you were meant to do it while the band was still there, and you could re-record it if it was.
Oh yeah.
And so I'd done a lot of editing.
Gosh.
And got myself into terrible situations with it, but
Ooh, I can imagine. Because if you cut it...
He's like, one simple rule, you just make sure you do it while the band's still there.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Fair enough.
Now editing is a lot easier, but it just takes so much longer because everyone wants to move everything, move every beat. And
wow.
I'm doing the Hoodoo Gurus at the moment, and Dave is extremely particular, as he deserves it. He's an incredible songwriter and Australian artist. But he literally moves every single beat in every song back and forward for ages.
That's it. One of the first things I learned as a child going to songwriting classes or whatever, I remember the person said, put your hand up if you can write a song in 5 minutes. And like everyone went, yes. And they said, well, most people spend years writing a song. And obviously you've got a great deal of experience coming from punk and then going through Albert's and working with the artists that you do now, you would have an opinion, a personal opinion on what you think makes a great song. We'd love to hear what you would have to say perhaps about songwriting, what you're listening for and what you think is a standout when it comes to a great song these days.
Oh, okay. It's a broad question. I think a great song is very hard to say, isn't it? It's all down to taste, and that's it.
Everyone has an opinion.
Yeah,
yeah, and I think that's a great thing to have your own opinion. And obviously, you're a producer. You're in a space where you can, say what you think makes a great song.
Yeah, I guess it's almost unanswerable. But I'm in a position where I'm getting 20 demos from a band. I have to come up with the 10 great songs or the 10 best songs. So you do have to try and listen and apply some rules. I suppose one of my fundamental... I mean, I like great inventive melody and tension in melody against the chords and something that is where the tension doesn't resolve too much. So keep the tension in the melody somehow. It's harder than it looks, I think. I guess there's many things to talk about here. But I think...
I love simplicity. That's like something that stands out to me. Something that can come across very simply is probably the thing that stands out to me, whereas my husband is completely the opposite, being a metal guitarist. He hears things I never hear or never want to hear.
Yeah.
But everyone has such a different vision.
Well, I think, if you've got really complex music, you can have a really simple vocal over the top, and that works really well. Like, particularly if it's sort of hypnotic music or something, you can have a driving beat and some complex chords and then a really nice, simple melody over the top. But I was going to say, I think one of the main rules I would apply, and which makes it very easy for me, is to make sure that a song has, two great parts. And at least one friend has told me that this is completely self-evident at this point. But I think if a song's got, a great verse and a great chorus, it's harder than it looks because I get so many demos where there's a great verse and then the chorus is a real letdown. And where you get a great, chorus and the verse is rubbish. And so, but if I can just go through a list of 20 songs and go, okay, there's 10 here that have a great verse and a great chorus, and the transition between those parts is really exciting, that's when it all comes together. It's like when you hear Neil Finn, Message to My Girl, and you hear that the transition into the chorus is incredible, the verse is incredible, and the chorus is incredible. And that's, like I say, it is self-evident, but you can ask yourself that question. And you can suddenly winnow out songs by just applying that, I think. Yeah, it's not that obvious, I don't think.
That's right, it's a subjective thing. Yeah. And as a producer, some of the best producers I've worked with have been able to offer me feedback in the studio, and you've got a couple of songs that you've mentioned that are songs where you've felt that have been able to go on a bit of a journey that you've worked with, and I just wondered if we could have a play from Mr. Soundman down there. Can you tell us a bit about, there's two songs that you've mentioned to me about songs that you've worked on. Tell us a bit about these ones.
So the first one might be the Cloud Control song. They're a great band from Blue Mountains, and this song they had, it's called There's Nothing in the Water, and it was just one great verse, that's all it was. And the record company like, this is a great verse. You should make something with this. And the band were like, well, it's not really a song, it's just a verse. And so the record company got them into the studio with me. And for we had 3 days to do this song. For the first 2 days, they'd just play the verse and stop And I'd go, just keep playing, keep jamming. And they'd go, no, it's not really a song. And Al the singer, is very stubborn. He's the loveliest guy on earth, and he's quite stubborn. He's like, it's not really a song. We don't have a song. And I'd be like, you've got the best verse ever. You don't need another great bit. In this case, it was, okay, going outside my little rule. But you just need something to tack onto the end of this. And the morning of the third day, Al's flatmate said, oh, why don't you try these chords? And they came in and they had the chorus bit. And it was a very simple, straightforward chorus. But, it was just, I guess in that case, my job is to be tenacious. And the song did really well and got in the top 20 of the Hottest 100. And they won $25,000 from APRA. No, wow. From Vander & Young, I think, songwriting thing. So it did really well for them, but they would never have released it without my tenacity, which I think is probably one of my most valuable assets.
That's right, because as a songwriter, just having somebody that knows and believes enough to have a listen and just give you that bit of feedback can make all the difference in where something's going.
Yeah.
Is it possible that we have a little listen to that? Is it far through the song, the verse and chorus?
It's worth hearing from the top. Yeah. And then the first chorus... I'll point out where they used to stop all the time.
Great.
Yeah, they'd sort of stop, but what else comes in just after this?
Oh, keep going. Oh yeah, I know this song. That's the chorus?
It's a very basic chorus, but I think the verse is so good that it
just pricks the ear, doesn't it?
Yeah. I think I wrote that bass line, in case you're wondering what I might do. Yeah. So that's that.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, that Nothing in the Water stands out to me for something I recognise as hearing.
Yeah.
But that's amazing. And they wouldn't have had that without your help.
I don't think so.
Yeah. Good.
I take most of the credit for that. They didn't give me any of the $25,000, by the way.
Damn it. And there's another example of another song I'd love for you to give some.
Just the last part of this song. This was Boy and Bear's cover of the Neil Finn song, and they had a big gap at the end. They're like, it's about a 40-second gap, and I was like, you've got to have something for that gap. So I played, I think, the guitar part on the end of this song and had the keyboard player doubling it on the keys and stuff. And they eventually met Neil Finn at his studio in Auckland, and he told them it was the best cover of any of his songs he'd ever heard.
Wow.
And I was like, did you tell them that I did it all and that I did that solo at the end? And they were like,
nah. I come from Wagga too. So do you know how far through the song is to cue that?
It's at least it's in the last minute or something, I think. Yeah.
Can we play the last minute of that other one, please?
Yeah.
Whenever I fall, whenever I fall.
So yeah, that's just the kind of thing you do in your day-to-day job.
Yeah,
putting bits and pieces in for bands. Yeah. A lot of bands don't want you to do anything. They're just like, don't tell us what to do. So there's every job is different.
Totally. So, oh, that sounds great. I really enjoyed that. Can I just check how much time we've got left? Oh, beautiful. Thank you. Well, do songs still have to stick to that 3.5 minute ratio to get on radio at the moment? Or whereabouts are artists sort of heading with songs at the moment that you're noticing?
That's a tough call. A lot of people talk about it, but I suppose... I don't know. I mean, Triple J has got a particular sort of sound, hasn't it, now? It's sort of doing quite a lot of electronica stuff or just more garagey skegs type stuff. Yeah. It's hard to... they don't seem to play much folk or anything anymore or sort of hard rock that I know of. Yeah. So I'm not really an expert on it. I don't do that much electronica. And I've done this band Babe Rainbow recently and they've been added to rotation. But I think they've done like 5 albums and they've... only just now been added to Triple J. So it's really, yeah, it's a lottery really, I think, getting on the radio. It's a little narrow. You know, they had a few songs a week and there's just thousands of songs coming out every week, isn't there? So
yeah, exactly, especially with Spotify and self-distribution and pushing yourself. So I know with a lot of artists, you know, contentious about Triple J, obviously it breaks a lot of artists that fit the mould. But with artists, and you would have worked with many and seen many over the years, and they would have taken all sorts of different paths to reach a level of success. Is there anything that you see artists doing at the moment that are mistakes or things that you would, if you could give some sort of advice to an emerging artist, like what might they be? Do you have any pearls of wisdom?
Gee, I don't know. Don't take too long, I guess, and just... being consistent with, you know, with what you do, I suppose, just like really keeping it going all the time. I think it's just very hard when you put out 2 songs, then take 3 years and everyone goes kind of cold on you. I don't know how you keep it up, though. Like, you've got it. I think if you've got a group of people and you're collaborating with a bunch and you can be sharing the songwriting and just pushing stuff out, that's a pretty good way to go. But, gee, there's a lot of bands out there that have done one big record. I don't know, like, say, The Preachers, for instance, and they did really great and then took them years to do the second record and it was hard for them to re-establish themselves. So I think that's somehow you've got to just keep churning stuff out. Yeah.
It can be hard, isn't it? Because life happens and you're a musician and it can be hard working with a group of crazy people and keeping that all together.
Yeah, that's right. In Sydney now, you can't really afford to live there and be a full-time musician.
Yeah.
So that makes... And there's no... I don't suppose the dole's very easy to get. So probably in the era of the 80s when there were so many bands, they were all on the dole and, you know, they were all basically living in cheap inner-city accommodation. It was a big community of people, you know. There were venues and that's all... That's kind of still around. That's all moved to Marrickville now, but it's not so much in the inner city of, you know, Darlinghurst and stuff anymore. Yeah.
Totally. And one thing when I listen, Wayne's got a Spotify playlist, so if you look up Wayne Connolly, you can find a lot of his work. And one thing that just stood out to me with the songs that I'd listened to was that you have this amazing niche and style. Obviously, you've done a lot of hard rock and certain, you know, Jimmy Barnes and very strong vocalists in the past. But a lot of the songs that I listen to have a beautiful... relaxed or chilled vibe with a beautiful soft vocal. We were just having a bit of a chat before about how a producer approaches a vocalist and how hard it is to get a right tone with a vocalist, because the vocalist is such an important part of the song.
For sure, yeah.
So can you tell us a bit about how you might approach that and whether or not this is a, you know, a niche or where you sit with your genres?
No, I spend a lot of time on vocals and I'd if ever I get tracks to mix from people, I notice they've only done like 4 takes of a vocal and I would often do 15 to 20 takes of a lead vocal. I think in terms of me doing a lot of more gentle stuff, that comes from having something successful like when I did Forever Young. I got lots of kind of and Boy and Bear, a lot of work in the folk realm, the Paper Kites and all those kind of bands. Previous to that, and I'd done the Vines and UMI and stuff, I got more rock work, and I did Dallas Crane. And yeah, that in some ways that rock vocal is harder to record. I think maybe we were talking about that before, that if someone's an absolute belter, the dynamics of it are quite hard to control, and it takes a lot of skill to kind of manage it. And I had a good lesson when I was first starting out, and I worked with UMI, and they had flown Lee Ronaldo out from New York. He was in Sonic Youth to produce. And on the first morning, and Lee had just got off the plane, and he was grumpy and wired. And I was trying to record Tim Rogers' vocal for the first time. And Tim, you could never get him to warm up. Like, Tim, you warmed up? And it's like, can you just test the mic? And then he started singing and just like pelted, you know, every needle in the room. It was just, everything was distorted, and Lee's yelling at me, and going, what the fuck, man? What the fuck are you doing? Because I didn't know him, and we just met, you know. And so it was very stressful. And from that day on, I was like, okay, I can't afford to ever have that happen again. Because it really was like losing a great moment.
You weren't sure what to do in that moment? Or?
No, it's just because Tim would never, you know, he speaks pretty quietly, and then he sings very loudly. So it was just trying to get him to test the mic, and he would never do it. You know, it's his fault. It wasn't mine. Yeah. Anyway, but from then on, I think I realised, yeah, there's a critical thing, which is having probably a valve mic for loud vocalists, or a good dynamic like an RE20 or an SM7. Or if I've recorded people like Tex Perkins, I use, you know, an RE20, if you're interested in that kind of technical stuff. And yeah, it basically, if you've got a big valve preamp that'll have a lot of headroom, and that's, and then a big fat compressor that will level it with a very fast setting, that's kind of what you need, and you've got to have all those things, really.
Yeah, absolutely. I love the SM7. I've always found that to be my personal
actually one
favorite.
More thing, sorry. Yeah. You know, I recorded Carice Eden, and she may be the loudest vocalist I've ever heard.
Wow.
It was just staggering. Like, you couldn't stand in the room with her singing. It was so loud.
Gosh.
And so, yeah, that was a matter of, I distinctly remember I didn't deaden the room enough, so it was very lively. I couldn't get the reverb out of her vocal, or the room sound. So with a very loud vocalist, you want to have a pretty dead room, whereas with a quiet vocalist, you can have a much more lively room, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. Like, just what producers actually hear in music. It always fascinates me what people hear in music, because I honestly don't pay that much attention, obviously. I'm not anywhere near the level of being able to produce, and so many producers or sound guys like that are obviously decent will never, ever drink while they're working, or, you know, it just deadens everything that they hear while they're trying to do their job, obviously. So do you have any sort of personal ways that you approach your work?
I guess everything's completely different, so you just never know what's coming, and you never know how it's going to work. Obviously, working with a band is a lot easier. The band's all been rehearsing, and they may have played songs live, and they've got everything kind of down, and then I can almost relax a bit and sit back and just record them. And for a long time through the 90s, that was the way most stuff was. And then you had solo people come along, like you know, your Josh Pikes, and suddenly he sings and plays guitar, and you've got to build everything around it. And that's a lot more common now, where you have to build a track around an acoustic guitar or whatever. Yeah. And that's time-consuming, and just a trial and error process, and jamming and trying different things, and just having a lot of tools at your disposal. So I work in a studio now in Surry Hills, and I have, you know, organs and pianos, and it's not my studio, by the way. But yeah, it's a matter of having a lot of tools at your disposal when you're trying to do that sort of thing.
And when it comes to, like, obviously you're working with some really successful names at the moment, but do you ever sort of hear from an emerging artist and think, wow, this is something pretty special, I wouldn't mind spending a few days with this artist?
Yeah, I do. I've got a record label now, which is completely insane. Don't ever start a record label. That's one bit of good advice I've got for you. And I've just been, working with some new artists, great Sydney band called The Nagging Doubts. I'll just give them a plug. They're kind of a bit sort of post-punky, really good, shouty vocals.
a band called Salaryman. They're fantastic. They've got kind of a 60s aesthetic. And a young girl, Ellen Sophie, who's a sort of a Julia Jacqueline kind of thing. So, yeah, I'm sort of working with all them. Salaryman do their own stuff, and I just give them tips, nagging doubts, record themselves, and I just maybe mix it for them. And yeah.
So did they approach you, or how did a mate say, hey, check these guys out? Or how?
Oh, no, that's an interesting thing. So I've never gone out and looked for work ever, and it's always just come to me. But this is a completely different, where I'm out there looking for bands and trying to sign them to label, and I'm going to gigs, and yeah, it's a completely different way of looking at the industry after all these years of just sitting in a cave.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Well, I'd love to be able to pop it out to you guys if anyone has any questions. If you'd like to ask Wayne anything in particular, you're most welcome to pop your hand up and throw something out to the crowd. Yes. We've got a mic.
How do you think the future for live performance is after COVID? Do you think it's the end of the festivals, like what happened with the Blues and Roots Festival this year? Is that the end of big festivals? Is it a small venue? Or?
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? A lot of people have lost a lot of money, and those big festivals are really struggling, and people have gone bankrupt. So it's very vulnerable, and you have to imagine a lot of people don't want to go through that whole process again. But I'm sure the big ones, Splendor, I think just got a big grant from the government to keep going. So those bigger ones will survive. Venues in Sydney are all kind of back up and running pretty much, and like the Lansdowne's very vibrant. And it's pretty exciting. Like, you go to a gig now and people are euphoric. It's like, and I think they now realise how valuable it is. People aren't quite as sort of like, whatever about gigs. They really get very excited. So I think it's pretty exciting and healthy. And it's a critical part of any scene. When I was in Sydney in the 80s, and there was the Hopetown and the Trade Union and Strawberry Hills, and there was all these venues in Surry Hills, and it was so amazing because, you know, they had to fill those venues six nights a week. And now Surry Hills is completely kind of empty, and the whole thing's moved to Marrickville. So I'm making the point that the venues add so much to the music scene, and, you know, Wagga needs a few really good venues probably. Yeah.
Definitely.
The Red Steer, is that still going? Yeah,
yeah, the Red Steer's done and plays some lots of good live music at the moment. It's really pushing ahead, and there's I think the Sporties is going to be opening up soon. I think the Duke's getting a new
Someone should PA reopen system. The Bootleg Wine Bar. Does anyone remember that?
No.
Bootleg was... It was... really? Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it was on the lagoon, so you'd go down this little back lane across the road from 2WG and this little lane into this little underground, sort of, wasn't underground, but it felt like it was. It was an underground bar, and it had sort of aluminium pie lids all over the ceiling. Like, it was like, with like 1,000 lights, and it was.
They had the lunchtime theatre, that same place. You go and get a little sandwich in the school holidays.
Someone should get some funding. Should crowdfund that. Get the Bootleg reopened. Yeah. Whatever happened to him? I wonder.
Wow.
Right. Yeah.
What's your take on Spotify?
Well, I was pretty resistant for a long time, and my band still haven't put this. We just put up a curated list. I was at Albert's at the time, and I'd argue with them all the time and say, you know, what the hell? It's like the end of the industry. I'd been in the UK in, I think, 2010. I was mastering a record, and the mastering engineer said to me, yeah, it's just the industry has died overnight because of Spotify. And I was like, really? Doesn't it cost money? He's like, no, everyone's on free subscription. It's just killed it stone dead overnight. And it was like 2 years later in Australia before that happened, I think. It was more 2012. And I was really resistant. I thought, It's just going to wreck everything, and it kind of has. It's taken musicians' income away, and people, record companies are making a lot of money. They're very happy. They've got back catalogues now, which are just bringing money in all the time. So it's just changed the paradigm so much. And I thought it would have been good if people just treated it like a radio station. You put up your four best songs, then you know, I don't know how else you deliver it really. But that paid download era, when like 2010, when that was just absolutely booming, that was an incredible time for the music industry, and bands were actually making a lot of money, and like Boy and Bear made a fortune in that period. And now it's just, yeah, money trickles in, and if you get 50 million streams, then you're kind of making a little bit, I suppose. But yeah, it's a bit unfortunate. Everyone sort of points to Tones and I and goes, look how much money you can make, but it's so rare, it's just ridiculous. So, yeah, I'm a bit cynical about it, but doesn't seem like there's any other way. I suppose I would try and, you know, pursue Bandcamp and use that method, because there are people out there, I think, that want to support musicians and just, you know, give them some money directly. Yeah.
You'd be surprised at how many people will actually go out of their way to buy your music and support you if you give them the opportunity to.
Yeah.
Does anyone else have another question? Don't be shy. It's interesting with the Spotify thing, because these days you as an emerging artist, and with, you know, Triple J being so hard to get airplay, and, you know, the fact that people aren't really listening to radio a whole lot, it's like you really do have to give things away in order for people to like you or build some sort of content.
Yeah.
Is there anyone out there that you're aware of that's doing a really good job, in your opinion again, about how they go about promoting themselves?
Well, Josh Pike's amazing at it. He just, you know, works out of his shed and promotes himself. But he has a big label, and he's through Sony and everything. But he does a lot of the work himself, and he's always got some social media trick going, getting other people to play his songs and things like that. So, yeah, he's done a lot of that lately. Get Ben Lee to play one of his songs.
Yeah, right. So it's about cross-promoting and collab and sharing with each other's sort of social networks and things like that.
But I suppose with my label now, I'm looking at it from a different way as well, and we've got a little bit of a budget we got from our distributor, and so we generally put that into like UK radio promotion, and most of our bands have been played quite a bit on BBC Six, and it's not that expensive to do that promotion, like you hiring a plugger, a radio plugger.
How much would that be?
We have a guy that does it for $400, but then we've had quotes of £400, sorry. Yep. We've had quotes for £1,500 to do that job as well by the best people, you know.
So when you employ a plugger, they actually go in and have a meeting with the radio station and say, here, this is what you need to listen to.
I doubt they still do that, but they sort of maybe have a friendship or a relationship with these people. They've known them a long time.
Yeah.
Some of those UK DJs have been in it a long time. I don't know. I mean, it's obviously very fashion-driven over there, but you still seem to get a better uptake than we do here. Like, they play stuff, and it's like still hard to get anything played here on Triple J or anything.
I think it's
not a bad way to spend a little bit of money to do that, and then it doesn't really lead anywhere, but you're getting a little bit of exposure in a big territory that is loyal to music.
It's challenging being like working on building in Europe, especially at the moment, because the borders are shut, so we're hoping that we'll see an uptake in regional touring out to these areas. So it's great that the venues are starting to build and our scene is starting to build as well. You had a question?
I'll give you the mic.
I was going to ask, is John Peel an example of a music promoter and a builder of artists and that? I mean,
yeah, he was incredibly valuable, and he'd play very obscure stuff and, you know, champion Australian stuff, and he did the live sessions as well back in the day. You know, he helped the Go-Betweens and the Triffids and the Birthday Party and Ed Cooper and all those people in that sort of golden age of Australians making it in the UK. So, yeah, that was an amazing, I think, just an amazing resource that is now gone. I think Steve Lamarck now kind of does a bit of that on BBC Six. So he's someone to target, I think, yeah.
I guess probably if we're ending our chat, the one question that I really wanted to end on with you is, being that we're able to sit here and look at the incredible career and the artists that you've worked with, obviously when you're successful yourself, you often don't feel it, or you often feel like there's so much further that you want to go personally. Mm. So I wanted to ask you about who some of your idols are, or what some of your bucket list might be in terms of your career, or what you're yet to do, or where you're headed.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say I have a reverse bucket list of things that I wish I'd done. Yeah. I got an email once about some guy called Vance Joy, working with him, and they were like, "Oh, can we meet with you, Vance? Well, you know, he's you know, really wants to talk to you about recording this new song he's got." And I never opened the email. And 2 years later, I saw my friend was managing Vance Joy. I was like, "Oh, I wonder if I should look through her emails." And there it was. And that was a bit disappointing. I met a band at an APRA Awards once called Regurgitator. And they were like, we'd love to work with you on our second album. And I was like, "Why not? Your first album's so good. Why don't you just do this album with Magoo again?" And they were like, "Yeah, okay."
They actually gatecrashed a party that I ran with bands at the Bowls Club around the back here.
Oh, really?
Probably 10 years ago. They heard the bands from the main street or something. I think they'd played a gig.
Really?
And they come knocking on the door and we had this big party and they were there dancing. It was great.
No way. Yeah.
You never know who's going to rock up to your gig in Wagga, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So are there any things on the horizon for you or things you're looking forward to?
I have a lot of stuff coming up, yeah. It's strangely busy. I don't really know why. I guess because people can't go overseas anymore. They're stuck here. So I'm doing an album with the girl from Tonight Alive, that rock band. And I'm doing an album with Emma Swift, who is from Wagga and now lives in London. And she's back in Sydney to do an album, yeah. And more Gurus finishing their album and more Babe Rainbow. I've just worked on a track. Babe Rainbow are one band that just know how to, you know, get their image out there. They're very connected into the surfing community, so you guys should probably all start surfing. That's probably the way to do it, you know. My brother was a Wagga surfer. He was had a surfboard.
Yeah.
But the Babe Rainbow stuff I'm doing at the moment is with Jaden Smith, who's Will Smith's son, and he's become a fan of theirs through Instagram or whatever. Yeah. And he recorded a song for them, and now we're recording a song for his album, which is exciting. And
yeah. Fantastic.
But yeah, my only bucket list thing is I would like to record at Abbey Road. I've been there, but I've never recorded there.
That would be pretty amazing. Yeah. It'd be like a cherry on the cake, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, all the way from Wagga to Abbey Road, I'm wishing you the best for your dreams and your future.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Please join me with a round of applause to thank Wayne for his time today.
And thank you, Phoebe. Thanks for your questions.